Okay, I'm playing Shroud of the Avatar again. First time on a video for a while. Recently, last month, Portal Enemy started doing free trial weekends. So I thought it would be interesting to create my own free trial account and run through the starting scenes. Hopefully, it's a bit of a guide to new players who haven't played before. You see up here next to the character name it says visitor. That's because it's a free trial account. I'm going to chat to Arabella. Manifestation, yep, continue, mirror, got it. Goodbye. I'm not going to bother reading too much quest stuff. If you've not played before, be aware this is a game to get the most out of the questing. You have to be prepared to read a load of stuff. But, you know, I'll leave that to you. Let's gaze into the mirror and manifest in the world. There we go. Don't want to be short. I'm thinking let's go for a sort of Scandinavian look. Bit blue, yeah, go for it. Go for it. That'll do. I'm not going to spend too much time on a character creation screen at this point. The free trial accounts, there's no guarantees they'll be kept after the free trial period, so don't spend any money or anything. Don't buy things in the add-on store. Don't expect any of this stuff to be around next week once the free trial's over. Just use it to see what the game's like. There are a number of limitations. Let's finish that sentence before I do anything else. You can't trade with other players. You can't use player vendors, and you can't put things into or take things out of public cash chests. You also can't flag for PvP, and you can't play in single player mode. So this is the character creation, your role creation. You can choose either love or truth or courage. There will be three questions. If you choose predominantly truth, you'll be a mage. If you choose predominantly courage, you'll be a warrior, melee type. And if you choose predominantly love, you'll be a ranger. The game at present recommends love because that's the most filled out starting quest. I'm going to go with that anyway, with a little bit of courage in the end. So I am now going to be a ranger. Path of bow, yeah, ranger, blah blah blah, meet your fate. If you want to be another path, you can choose that. Though it should be pointed out, it's not really much of a limitation. You can essentially pick up any skills you want once you get into the game. Now, they've been doing a lot of work on this starting setup, so to speak, and there'll be even more new stuff next month in R41 as they're building brand new starter areas which become between the next scene you're going to see, Solis Bridge, Battle of, and Soul Town. There'll be a large, basically newbie area, so that new players don't spend a significant portion of their first hour or so playing the game zoning in and out of things. So this is the Path of the Bow starting scene. I'm going to zoom out a bit. You'll see there's some text up there. We'll go into the house. We'll investigate. We'll investigate this letter from Johan, maybe. We'll investigate this corpse. And we find it probably is Johan. He's talking about Abigail, his wife, and Charlotte, his daughter, who he's looking for before the worst happens. And since he's lying dead here, let's assume the worst has happened. We'll head upstairs. Interesting that there's a whole bunch of skeletons around here. So these translucent skeletons occur when a player dies in the game. So I'm not sure how they were managing to commit suicide in here. Maybe they're setting fire to themselves. I'm going to speak to Charlotte here. I'm going to help Charlotte. If you don't help Charlotte, when you come back to the permanent version of this scene later, you will find a little corpse lying up there in that bedroom. And you also will upset her mother. So you don't want Charlotte to die, really. It's like the introductory consequence quest this is. If you don't rescue her now, and if you don't collect this stuff now, there's no opportunity to come back and do it again. Once it's done, it's done. So we're going to go in here. We're going to speak to Edvard the Wanderer. He's going to tell us, quick, grab that bow. Which we do like this. And also, he will give us arrows. And we'll check at this point. If we look, you see I start off with some range skills. And 10,000 XP. What I'm going to do, because I don't actually want to be a ranger, is turn these skills off. So they're not going to increase. And I'm actually going to try pole arms. So even though I've spoken to Edvard and taken the bow, you'll see over here on the weapons rack there is some other weapons. A rusty spear. Let's just have a quick look. Rusty spear, let's equip that. So I can be whatever I want. It doesn't matter that I've chosen bows as a starting quest. Let's speak to him again. Right, ready to cross the bridge. He gives us some arrows, which we're not going to use because we're pole arming. I'm also not going to use this skill in our starting deck. What we are going to do is attack things. There we go, with our new spear. And look at that, my skills are going up. And if you look here, you'll see my pooled experience is going down as the skill goes up. So that's basically how it works. You gain experience for killing things and completing quests. So if we look again, it should go up when something dies. Go on, die, Mr. Awakened Dead. Well, I didn't spot it. There it went up. It went up when that one died. It does work. I'm going to loot the bodies. There are a bunch of other bodies on this bridge, which you also can loot. But be aware that one of the aims of the game is that it's tracking your virtue. So when you start looting corpses, that does have consequences for your virtue. At the moment, that won't have much consequence in the rest of the game. There's nothing too much significant that has an impact, but it is planned that... Oh, I didn't really want to speak to Charlotte. I wanted to loot the corpse. It is planned that various quest options will be available, not available. Oh, there it is. Excuse me, based on your current level of virtue. But like I said, that's not in the game yet. That's just something to bear in mind for the future, because your virtue is permanent and will apply to all characters. All characters on your account, which again, you can only have one in a minute, so it's not too big of a deal. really all I'm getting across to you here is that the things you do in this starting scene can have consequences for your character in the long term. Oh, I walked into the wall. There is a bug on Linux that if a window or resource node opens while you're running along with the right mouse button held down, it breaks a mouse lock and you end up walking to walls and doing other embarrassing things. It is annoying. I've come to terms with it. Just play the game. You may find it too frustrating to control your character. You'll see for yourself. It's a free trial, so you can check out these sort of things. So, we have completed the opening quest. Now this is a real scene. You won't get back into it at any point after you've left. So if you want to explore it, 7,000 experience for completing that quest, as we noted earlier. He wants his help. He's got a favour. We get some stuff. Goodbye. So, yes, like I said, you can run around this scene. You won't get back in this version of the scene at any point, so if you've never played before, it might be a little bit worth it for you to explore. But I'm not going to bother looking now. I think, let's make sure Charlotte doesn't follow us. Yes, so we've succeeded in rescuing Charlotte. That's what the 7,000 XP was for. This is the way out of the opening scene. It is easy to miss if you didn't read what Edward told you. I'm going to head to Saltown. Now, like I said, in the next release there will be an intermediate scene which will be very large with lots of adventuring opportunities between that scene and Saltown, but for now we're going to Saltown. So here we are. We need to speak to the Saltown guard captain. Tell him my name is Chevette. We'll get these pop-up hints, which I'm also going to ignore. We're going to talk to him about Edvard, and he's going to ask about these notes. He's actually going to give us the notes back. So, questing. Let's get this out of the way while we're talking. Basically, if you say help to almost any NPC that has a quest, he will tell you, or the NPC will tell you about the quest they want you to do. Help is the key word to look for there. So, I've received a quest from Stanley in Ardoris to deliver a letter to Captain Cudgel. There are a bunch of other quests available. Your starting quests are at that camp over there. Let's head over and there's another visitor. So I can complete a quest by talking to this woman, because this is Abigail, who you should remember is the husband of Johan and the mother of Charlotte. So if we talk to her, I gain experience and I learn an emote. Just like that. Which means I can now do back flip. Boom. Look at the creative possibilities. So that's a quest. That's a quest we can do. I think, let me just count up. I think four of these characters standing around the campfire also have quests. I'm, for time's sake, not going to bother getting into all of that right now. Instead, I'm going to run into town. So you'll see there's a whole lot of buildings. These are all player buildings. If we go over here and have a look at, for instance, this. This is a commission-free vendor. We cannot use this vendor because it's a free account. So that's what I was talking about earlier about the limitations. And the carrier in anyway. More player housing. all of the player housing is not part of any plot line you may be wanting to do. So I'm going to first of all speak to the town crier. Every town that has player housing will have a town crier. If you talk to the town crier that you've not talked to before, you will get 100 gold. So especially early in the game, when you don't have much money, 100 gold for each new town you visit is pretty useful. They also have mail quests. If you're a new player, I recommend you stick to local mail quests. You'll see we've got a mail package for Arduris, which is excellent because I wanted to go there anyway. So I'll say goodbye to him. This is all the housing that you can't do anything with or about because you're a free player. There's so the purple names are devs, just so you know. So there are a couple of quests I'm going to look at. This bloke here, he needs our help. Conveniently, it's a keyword. And if you click on take the fight to the dead, he asks you to find a keepsake of his grandmother's. Now, to get that keepsake, it's a random drop from killing zombies in Solace Bridge. So I won't actually do that quest today because it could take a while. This is the bank, which is your only option for storage because you're not allowed to access any public chests as a free player. While I'm in here, I'm going to pick up a quest I am going to do. That bloke over there, not the one that's dancing, the bald one, I'm going to talk to him. He wants to know what name I go by. He has an offer. Key. Right, so he wants his key from the East Perennial Trail. So that's an achievable quest. I'm going to hit J at this point to show you my current tasks. These correspond to the list that you may have been seeing popping up. You have a little text here that tells you the task is at an appropriate level. So, we've got a couple of quests. We're going to try and walk out. There we go, come on. There we go. We're walking out. We're going to have a look over here at the combat trainer. So at the minute, I've got a very basic starting deck. If I get my skills up, I could, if I had them, drag them down onto the bar. I can do without that because I'm not doing bow stuff. In order to get these skills, you talk to the combat trainer and you'll see I can purchase, actually I've got 308 gold, just enough. I'm going to buy all three of these skills. So you'll see the ones that are red I can actually use in combat. So if I drag them down onto the bar here, they'll go in like that. This one on a different colour background is an innate skill, which gives me a range bonus on my pole arm, and that will improve over time as I use other skills in the pole arm tree. There is some more interesting stuff when you talk to the skill trainer, but let's wait and go out and do my questing first. So now I have to run back out of town. This will take a minute. Play amongst yourselves. We're going to get up onto the back to the, well, for the first time onto the overworld map. See, there's the exit there. So I've picked up, well, I've got four quests in total. find Bentley's key, find the keepsake, deliver the mail, deliver the last cudgel. So because I know where these quests are and I want to keep this fairly focused, I'm going to ignore the find the keepsake quest for now. When we get onto the world map, after the loading screen, which is something you'll have to put up with, unfortunately. So here we are on the overworld map. If we look down that way, that Solace Bridge, just you can see it in the distance there. That's where you need to go for the keepsake quest. I, however, am going to go this way. Find the East Perennial, there it is, East Perennial Trail. Here we go. So one thing I should point out while we're looking at the UI, well, you're not really looking at it, are you? But there you go. Because I've played on this computer before, the settings are inherited from what I played. You will have a slightly different looking UI, I should think. Probably have reticle and stuff like that. I've done away with all of it because I don't like the reticle. But the nature interactions doesn't change whether you're using a mouse lock mode or reticle mode. Right, so now we can fight skeletons. Yes. And you see, I've already leveled up my skills. Do a bit of healing. Let's see if we can get this one. Kill one of them, concentrate on the other. Now you see my innate going up as well. If we look at that, you'll see my experience is going down rapidly. The concentrating on one isn't really working out for me, to be fair. Let's do a bit more healing. There we go. So, I've succeeded in killing two skeletons. I've gained a whole load of skills. I've lost some experience. And I need to heal. So I can also... I think I've got some potions and stuff. There we go. So we've got health potions and focus potions. They can just be dragged onto your toolbar from the inventory, like anything else. If we go in here, you'll find there's a note. Somewhat suspicious. There's a key here. Key from house. Double click it. Oh, now I'm encumbered. Not that that's important at the moment. We go up the stairs, we can see the sort of business that was being operated in this farmhouse. That's all shady. So, I found his key. It's not updated to the checkbox thing, but that was the key. All this stuff is being worked on. And we'll find a way out. And what I'll do is head to Ardoris and deliver the mail. And also the letter to Captain Cudgel. So, another loading screen. Which is one of the main criticisms of the game. They are actually much faster than they used to be. So, there is that. And like I said, they are trying to put a whole new starter scene in where you can do a bunch of quests and other things right after the Battle of Solace Bridge, so you don't have to see too many loading screens in the first few hours, but that's not in yet. So this is Ardoris on the coast. In we go. So this is the major city in this area, and it's sort of central to the love quest line. So you'll probably spend a bit of time going in and out of it. It is a much larger town with a whole lot of player housing and decoration, so it can be slow to load into. As we're seeing, it's moving along a bit now, look. And now it's at the point where it's trying to synchronise the data across the network, so on a scene with lots of players in it, that can be the sticking point. And we're in. So we can have a look and see how many players are on the scene. If you hit zero on your main keypad, there are the players that are currently present. Well, it's not too many. Now, Ardoris, being a big town, has a sort of internal transport network which you can access by visiting these boatman characters. There are also some boats positioned around the city. So I want to go to the Oracle Confirmatory, which is actually just across the bridge there. Here I am. As we look over this way, there's a bridge that I didn't bother running across. And here is the Ardoris Town Crier, for whom we have a mail delivery. And I'll receive 75 gold for delivering. I'll pick up another one. Celestis. Right. Now that we've got the mail, if I walk away from him for a bit, and then run back towards him, talk to him again, and I'll get the 100 gold for visiting the town crier for the first time. Here are all the lots taken in Ardoris. If you want to find a particular lot, click on the list, set compass destination, and you'll get a little green indicator in compass to show you where the lot is. I'm not going to bother looking for that lot at the minute. I'll leave that. I'm going to run back over the hill. I'm going to encounter a glitch on the stairs. Now I want to go to Zaquana Square, which is basically the other side of the Oracle there. So rather than run, I'll go back to the boatman. And Zaquana Square. There we go. And that will take me out right by the blacksmith shop. So because I'm encumbered, as you can see there, I can go to the blacksmith. I can sell from inventory, and I can get rid of a bunch of rusty swords. 88 gold. I'm rich. Well, no, I'm not. While I'm here, I'm going to talk to Zangoff. If I talk to him about axes, I get the dance keyword. If I talk to him about dancing, he will talk about moving like the wind. And what that would have done, or should have done, is give me the blush emote. That's me blushing. And the belly dance emote. That's me belly dancing. Exciting, I know. So, back out to the square. The main skill trainer in Ardoris is usually located in this area. Although, because it's night, he may have gone to bed. He's probably around somewhere, though. Ooh. We are getting some lag now. Guild registrars. NPCs that shut the door behind you. sometimes even before you've walked out of it. If we go along here a bit, this house has a whole bunch of trainers in. So here we are, Master Blaze Trainer, Master Shields Trainer. If I click the hello key, you can talk to him. We can't talk to him about anything useful. We'll come back here in a minute. In the meantime, let's head to the docks area. Again, I'm going to use the boatman, because we still have to deliver the letter to Captain Cudgel. So we want to go to the docks. We want to go up the hill, up these steps. And this building here is the guardhouse. That is Captain Cudgel. So it's not giving us an option. Can he ask for help in the form of a question? Soul Town. Yes, I do. There you go. A letter from Stanley to guard Captain Cudgel Ardois. Give items. I've learnt to perform salute. I've wrote some stuff in my journal. And that is the start of the main part of the love quest, which I'm not going to get into today. Hopefully I've got some XP out of it. Looks like it. So, I've got some gold and got other stuff I'm doing quests. There we go, 300 gold. I'm going to show you a source of income for when you're a new player. Let's go back down to the boat. And go back to the Oracle Confirmatory, which we've been to before. This time I'm going to get in and talk to the Oracle. So I've done a few quests. I'll talk to you about the virtues. Doing the quests also affects the virtues. And the only place where it all really matters at the minute is when you talk to the Oracle. So there's a bunch of stuff you have to get through to get the Oracle to be ready to talk to you. The virtues is what you're looking for. When you talk about truth, it will say, I require weekly consultations. What you've got to remember is that a day in our world is a week in Novia. So it doesn't really mean a week, it means tomorrow. You want to talk again. The Oracle will tell us that it's observed our actions and we've not acted in any significant way on the virtue of truth. Let's try love. And you see here it says, what I've witnessed in general show that you consider this virtue important. And so that's the that's significant. Courage. Again, not significant. So consider this virtue significant means is code for you've got positive virtue in that thing. So, if you type test, when you come back and talk to the Oracle later, test will be one of the underlying keywords. It will ask you about one of the virtues. Now, if you've been through what I just did and see what the Oracle says about your compliance with the virtue, you will know how to answer. If it said you consider this important, you have to answer yes. If it says you hold this virtue in some disdain, you have to answer no. And it's asking about the path of love. And do I live according to the virtue of love? And we know because I looked up and it didn't say I hold it in some disdain. Yes, should work. 500 gold and 500 experience. That's how it works. So if it says disdain when you ask it about one of the three virtues, and then it asks you about that virtue, say no. Otherwise, say yes. So we've done some questing. We've done some wealth management. I'm going to head back to the main gate and return to Soul Town. And actually, while I think about it, let's go into the Sun Tree and stick some light on our bar. There we go. That's better. Now we can see where we're going. So there we go. I'll pop back to Soul Town. I'll give Bentley his key, and then we wrap up the video. Yeah, another loading screen. Hopefully not too long this time. Or maybe not. So there is one more thing which may be discussed. At the minute we've got a fairly simple toolbar thing going on the bottom of the screen. That's like a new mode for this release. If I get a Soul Town, you can unlock some other features of that toolbar. Let's see how it goes. Oh, so that bandit over there is a roving encounter. If you go near him, he will pull you into a scene where you have to fight some bandits. There are skeleton encounters, there are wolf encounters and some stuff like that. If you're the same level I am now, you will probably die if you enter one of those encounters. On the other hand, if you practice them a bit and figure them out, quite often you can get a good amount of useful resources out of them. So especially as a new player, I would recommend seeking them out and figuring out how you can actually defeat the enemies. Yeah, split them up, try and kill them one or two at a time, and you'll soon get it sorted out, and you will find that they are full of various useful things like ore and wood and cotton. So I'm heading back into central town. Let's cast some more light. Now I've leveled it up. I expect to be quite busy in here this evening because we'll have the free trial and we have all the people who are waiting around trying to help people on free trials. We have a bit of a meeting going on here. I'm going to go into the pub and speak to Bentley. There he is. Key. Yes, I have. $500, 200,000 experience. Suspicious. Suspicious, moi. He has no idea. Farm. Good luck, good fortune. Right, so that's a nice little starting quest because you don't have to do very much. You get some experience and some gold. I'm going to nip across the way here back to that skills trainer. Hello, semi-naked lady. So if you click on the hello keyword, it'll give you this dialogue where you can talk about advanced techniques. So these things used to be all by default. You used to get them right at the start. They've simplified the whole starting experience by pushing them here in when you talk to a skill trainer. So I'm going to unlock the utility hotbar. Yes. And I've got 200 gold for doing it. I'm going to unlock deck building. Yes. So the utility hotbar. You'll see that now I have a different set of things. All of my combat skills are gone. If I hit Z to get my sword out, you'll see my combat skills are now up there. I don't need light on it though. Now that it's my combat bar. And also potions can be on your utility bar so they don't take up a slot on your actual combat bar. Which isn't a big deal at the minute because I've only got two actual combat skills. But if you look here, now I've unlocked the decks. If I had more skills, and I do have some skills, look. So let's put them up there. So I've got two of each. There's Embrace. They're not skills I'm going to use much, to be fair, because it would be heavy armour. I'm going to stack those ones here, look. Yep, unlock it. There you go, dodge. Just to show you how this all works. And I'm going to unlock them so they come straight in. Right, so I've changed my deck. And now when I hit Z, you will see that skills get dealt in, which means I can do things like combo them so they have bigger effects. At the minute, because I've got so few skills, a lot of the skills are slugs, which are obviously useless. As you level up, you'll be able to put more skills in the deck and lose the slugs. So that's why they've basically cut it off from new players, is because it's not actually useful to you until you've got enough skills to be able to wipe out all the slugs. So there you go. That's hopefully a fairly short video of how to get around as a free trial player in Shroud the Avatar R40. Hope it was useful. If you have any questions, post a comment on the video or contact me in-game with my main character, Winterbeat of Koth, and I'll try and help.